Peaceful, 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 peace.
Let's discuss the educational rights of the women in Islam. The first guidance revealed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by Almighty God, to the whole of humankind in His last and final revelation, the glorious Quran, it was not to offer salah, it was not to give charity, it was not to fast, but it was ikra. It was to read, to proclaim, to repeat. And the first five verses revealed of the glorious Quran was from Surah Ikra, chapter number 96, verse number 1 to 5. He says, Ikra bismi rabbika allazi khalaq, khalaqal insana min alaq, ikra wa rabbuka al-akram, allazi allama bil kalam, allama insana ma lam ya'lam. Read, recite, proclaim in the name of the Lord who created the men from something which clings, a leech like substance. Read in the name of the Lord who's most bountiful, who taught men the use of the pen, who taught men that which he did not know. The first guidance given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, it was to read, and it was to both male and female. Our beloved Prophet Muhammad said, it's mentioned in Sahih Hadith of Ibn Majah, Hadith number 242, the beloved Prophet said, Talibul ilm faridatun ala kulli Muslim. It is obligatory on every Muslim, man or woman, to acquire knowledge. The Prophet specially told the parents to educate the children, especially the daughters. It is the duty of the husband to give education to their wife, especially religious education. And if they don't, she has the right to go to the court, to the judge, and demand for it. If he cannot teach it himself, he'll have to send her and see to it that he educates her. There is a chapter in the Sahih Bukhari, when one hadith, the woman, they approach the Prophet and they tell him that you're always surrounded by men. Why don't you give us a special time? And the Prophet agreed and used to specially dedicate time to educate only the women. He also sent sahabas to specially educate the women. And if you read the history of Islam, 1400 years ago, in the days of ignorance, in Yawm al-Jahiliyyah, at that time, we have examples of many women, several women who were scholars. The best example I can think is Aisha bint Abi Bakr, may Allah be pleased with her, the wife of the Prophet. And one of a very famous student by the name of Arwa, may Allah be pleased with her, she says that I have not come across a scholar greater than Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, in learning of the Quran, in obligatory duties, in lawful and unlawful things, in literature and poetry, in Arabic history and genealogy. And when we read the seerah of Hazrat Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, we find out that she lived many years after the death of the Prophet, and she guided many of the Sahabas, and she even guided all the Fuqaha al-Rashideen. Many a times when foreign delegations came to the Prophet and when they discussed medicine, etc., Hazrat Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, her memory was very good. She used to memorize them. She was also an expert in mathematics. And after the demise of the Prophet, many of the Sahabas came to her, especially while dealing with Mirath, while dealing with inheritance, because she was expert in mathematics. History tells us that she has taught several scholars. She has taught no less than 88 different scholars. So in short, she was a scholar of the scholars. And only on her authority alone, there are no less than 2,210 hadith reported only on the authority of Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her. We have the example of Salma, may Allah be pleased with her, who was the wife of the Prophet. And according to Imam An-Nawawi, she was the most intellectual woman amongst the learned women. And according to Ibn Hajar, he calls her as an authority. We have the example of Safiya, may Allah be pleased with her, who was the wife of the Prophet. And Imam An-Nawawi calls her as an intellectual woman. We have the example of Fatima bint Qais, who was one of the Sahabiya of Prophet. But she was so learned, and the immense knowledge she had, that once there was a discussion on issue of fiqh, and she had a point of view, and Hazrat Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, and Hazrat Uthman, may Allah be pleased with him, they objected, but they could not prove her wrong. She was so knowledgeable. We have the example of Sulaima, may Allah be pleased with her, who was the mother of Hazrat Anas, may Allah be pleased with him, who was the famous Sahaba. And according to Ibn Hajar, he says that she was a very intelligent woman. And Imam An-Nawawi calls her as authority. We have the example of Darda, who was the wife of Abu Darda. And Imam Bukhari, in his Sahih Bukhari, he calls her as an authority on the science of Hadith. We have the example of Sayyidina Nafisa. Sayyidina Nafisa, she was a scholar, and she taught many students. One amongst her student was Imam Shafi. We also have the example of Aisha bint Saad Ibn Abi Waqas. She too was a scholar, and amongst her student, one of the student was Imam Malik. May Allah be pleased with him. May Allah have mercy on him. Rahimullah. Imagine, at the days of ignorance, in Yawm al-Jahiliya, there were several women who were scholars. At that time, people were hardly educated, and imagine, we have an example of several women who were great scholars. Let's discuss the legal rights of the women in Islam. Legally, men and women are equal. If for the crime they commit, they get the same punishment. For example, if a man kills a woman, the man is put to death. If a woman kills a man, she is put to death. According to the law of Qisas, mentioned in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 178 and 179. And furthermore, if any organ of the body is damaged, irrespective whether it is the eye, the ear, the hand, irrespective whether it's of man and a woman, male or female, the punishment is the same. And if suppose someone murders someone, and if the family members want to forgive by taking diya money, it doesn't make a difference who is forgiving, whether the family member is a man or a woman, both of them are equal. They have the right to forgive. The punishment for the men and women in Islam for the same crime, it is the same. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Maida, chapter number 5, verse number 38, as to the thief, be it a man or a woman, chop off his or her hand as a punishment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If someone robs, irrespective whether it's a male or a female, the punishment is the same, it is the chopping of the hands. Quran says in Surah Nur, chapter number 24, verse number 2, as for the fornicator, whether it's a female or a male, whether it's a woman or a man, give each 100 lashes as punishment. That means if someone does fornication, irrespective whether it's a woman or a man, the punishment is the same, 100 lashes.